Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the AAS YouTube channel. And this is part of the good stuff. This is the AAS Journal Author Series. And I'm very happy to have Alicia Garofalo with us today. Hi, Alicia.
Hi, everyone. Hi, everyone. Hi, Frank. Hi there. How are you?
I am doing really well. It is September 27th, 2021, as we're chatting here. And so we are past, I'm in Phoenix, and so we're past equinox. So we went by the equal day, equal night. And where are you located at, Alicia?
I'm in Ferrara, that is a city close to Bologna, where I work. And it's a small city close to Bologna. And so I can go and go back to Bologna in 25 minutes. Oh, we are in fall now, so the temperature are the typical temperature of this season. So it's foggy here in the north of Italy.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Very good. Very cool. Very cool. Let's see. So are you allowed back into your research institution, or is that still off limits with the pandemic?
No, we went back to the institute in May slowly.
Okay, but
I guess that next month we will all the people in the institute can go back to work. So it's a fantastic new, I guess.
Yeah, that's fantastic. That's let's hope it continues.
Yeah, sure.
Super. So Lisa, what do you like to do for research?
Yes, my topic, I guess, the topic that I'm going to follow from the early part of my career is the study of the stellar content and the pulsating variable stars in the ultra-faint dwarf spheroidal galaxies, which are galaxies that are satellites of the Milky Way. And so using the study of the stellar content and the pulsating variable star, we can better understand the nature of these systems, and in particular, the connection of this system with the Milky Way.
Cool. Awesome. And that is going to bring us to this very lovely APJ article, Born in a Pair. Yes. Pisces 2 and Pisces 3. Alicia, take us away.
Okay, so first of all, I would to say thank you to the fantastic co-authors of this paper. They gave me a huge help to improve the quality of this work. Mm-hmm. This is the first study of variable sources in these galaxies, in these ultra-faint dwarf spheroidal galaxies, using which kind of data, B and V, so optical time series photometry that we acquired at the Large Binocular Telescope. The first question maybe is why we decide to study this object, Pisces and Pegasus, and why the ultra-faint dwarf spheroidal galaxies in general, but also why the this kind of telescope, the Large Binocular Telescope. So starting from the more general question, so why the ultra-faint dwarf spheroidal galaxies? Let me say that these galaxies are a sort of new class of galaxies, because the first ultra-faint dwarf spheroidal galaxies has been discovered in 2005, so no more than 20 years ago, thanks to the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. Yep. And now the number of these system is dramatically increased. Now we have 50 ultra-faint dwarf spheroidal galaxies. Why these systems are so important? They, due to the fact that, let me say that in the modern astronomy, it's absolutely a trend topic, the try to understand the mechanism who driven the formation and the evolution of the Milky Way. These systems under the lambda dark matter paradigm theory seems to be the survivors, the witness of these of the accretion events, the build-up of the stellar halo of the Milky Way. So for this reason, these systems are quite interesting. Mm-hmm. And why we decide to study in particular Pisces and Pegasus. The ultra-faint dwarf spiral galaxies are, as I said before, these systems that are characterized, as the name says, by a super low luminosity, and they are small systems characterized by generally an all-stellar population. All stellar population, that means older than 12 GigaS, with metallicities that are absolutely compatible with the most metal poor galactic globular cluster, but also similar to the metallicities that we have in the external part of the galactic halo. So right. This is the stellar content of the ultra-faint dwarf spiral galaxies in general. Mm-hmm. Has been found that in work that is in literature, that maybe these two galaxies, Pisces 2 and Pegasus 3, due to the fact that they are 8.5 degrees apart in the sky, has been hypothesized that this system are in a such a way connected. So we decided to investigate the stellar content, the pulsating variable stars in this system that are generally the RR stars, because of the RR stars are tracers of old and metal poor stellar component. And we decided to use the Large Binocular Telescope, because thanks to the large field of view of the Large Binocular Telescope, it's possible to have the field of view of this observation that can cover an area that is 9 times the half-life radius of Pisces 2 and 12 times the half-life radius of Pegasus 3. That is quite cool. I mean, and so we collected this data, and the first thing that we made has been the identification of variable sources. Mm-hmm. And to do that, we collect a PSF catalog. So we performed a PSF photometry, and we decided to starting from the identification of variable sources. To do that, we, and this is the first step, we used an index, a variability index, and we selected all the sources with this high variability index, and we double check this sample, filtering all the sources that in the color magnitude diagram are located in the instability strip, so the place in which the pulsating variable stars are generally, and we analyzed using a visual inspection the light curves of the candidates the candidate variables. So if we go to figure, I guess, 2, but also 1, see.
On figure 2 or figure 1?
Yes, or only figure 1, maybe, yes. One. The light curves of Pisces 2, the light curve of the sources for which we confirm the variability. The first figure is the first image on the left is RR star with a period around 0.55 days. Uh-huh. And the second one is S6 Phoenicis, candidates as S6 Phoenicis, because as you can see, the variability is present on the left, but not on the right. So in the B band, but not in the B band.
Got it.
And also the third variable source is an S6 Phoenicis for which we confirm the classification. Uh-huh. The S6 Phoenicis is another kind of tracer of POP2 stars, so like the RR star. Mm-hmm. Confirm us that this system are characterized by all stellar populations. And the last source that we identified in Pisces 2 is a source for which we couldn't give a firm classification. So we found two periods that are equally plausible. This source, using the longer period, can be classified as an RR star AB star with period around 0.72 days. Uh-huh. And if we use the shorter period, can be an anomalous Cepheid with a period around 0.41. To see the distribution of these sources in the field of view of the Large Binocular Telescope respect to the center of the galaxy, we have to go to figure 2.
Okay.
This figure, yes.
Okay.
In this figure, you can see, going from the center of the galaxy, that the first star is the bona fide red star, the star with a period around 0.55 days, the magenta square, that is completely within the half-life radius of the galaxy. The half-life radius is the inner annulus, exactly. Okay. And then going to the blue triangle, you see the S6 Phoenicis. And the last red dot is the unconfirmed, the uncertain classic, the star with uncertain classification. So, okay. The star that can be or an array star or an anomalous effect. Mm-hmm. Particular thing that I have to stress is that the this unclassified source is characterized by a longer period respect to the bona fide or the star, of course, but is also characterized by a luminosity that is higher than the bona fide or the star, so around 0.3 magnitudes. Okay. And is also, as you can see, far from the center of the galaxy. Is in an area that is within 5 times the half-life radius of the galaxy,
yeah.
And it's quite far the respect, for example, to the bona fide red star that is completely in the center of the galaxy.
Yeah.
To compare the distance of this source with the star's members of the galaxy, we marked with the empty circles, red circles, the spectroscopically confirmed member stars.
Okay.
That are RGB stars spectroscopically confirmed by previous paper, Kirby et al. 2015.
Okay.
And as you can see, also the stars are outside the half-life radius. So we are quite confident that for sure the bona fide red star and the S6 Phoenicis are members of the galaxy, but about the V4, we label this star V4, the uncertain star, the uncertain variable, we have to better understand at this level, looking only the light curve, better understand the nature of this object, also in terms of membership. And let me go to the figure 4, so the map of sources, but in the respect to the Pegasus center.
Uh-huh, let me get that up, and there we go.
Yes, sure.
All right, Eck.
Thanks. And again, looking at the variable sources that we identified in this galaxy, you see that the situation is not so different respect to Pisces 2. I can explain this sentence. The first star that we identified as a variable star is the red dot, and is in an area that is 5 times the half-life radius of the galaxy. Uh-huh. This star is a bona fide red star with a period around 0.55 days. So basically the same period of V1 in Pisces 2.
Yep.
And the other variable that we identified here is V2, and is the marked with this empty red circle. This star is within 10 times the half-life radius, so quite far from the center of the galaxy. Yeah. And again, also for this star, we couldn't give a firm classification. This star can have two periods that are equally possible for us. And again, this star can be or an anomalous Cepheid or an array star according to the shorter or the longer period that are equally possible.
Mm.
And like the V4 in Pisces 2, also this star that we labeled V2 in Pegasus 3 is characterized by a luminosity that is higher than the luminosity around 0.3 magnitudes brighter than the bona fide array star, and is quite far from the center of the galaxy. So again, the same problem. We have, first of all, try to understand the real nature of this object and try to understand the membership. And we have done in figure two, in also in this figure, the spectroscopically confirmed member from literature are the stressed in this map and are the blue stars and the yellow stars. And are all RGB stars, yes.
Yep.
And as you can see, again, also these stars are outside the half-life radius of the galaxies because one of the properties of the ultra-faint dwarf spiral galaxies is that these stars are for sure old stars, so absolutely relaxed. But the point is that these systems are characterized by irregular shaped, distorted morphology due to the interaction in the past having with the Milky Way.
Cool.
And so we having this bona fide array star in which we trust, we used these luminosities, the mean luminosity of the array stars, to measure the distance to this system. And we used different relations followed by the array star to derive these distances. Different relations, but at the end we adopted the relation from Clementine et al. 2003. This luminosity metallicity relation, that is the relation followed by the array stars that we can use to derive the distances, is a relation that we used as a reference because, and yes, you can see the distance moduli that we performed for Pisces and Pegasus in this listed in table six. We use this, the Clementine et al. Relation as reference because it's the relation that we used in other work in which we derive distances using the array stars in the ultra-faint dwarf spiral galaxy. So simply to make a sort of comparison, consistent comparison, but we know that there are also the Gaia DR2 data and that this relation can be improved and can be more accurate. And so we used also the Muravev et al. 2018 relations to make a comparison and also to maybe in the future when the Gaia parallaxes will be, when the we will arrive at the last Gaia release. And so this relation will be the most accurate relation. We can make a sort of a better comparison using, for example, these distance moduli coming from the Muravev et al. 2018 relation.
Okay.
So, focusing our attention on the Clementine et al. Distance moduli, I have to say that we don't use only the luminosity, of course, but we have to introduce the metallicity in this relation. Which kind of metallicity we use? We have a sort of dilemma, let me say, because we have the spectroscopic metallicity coming from the literature.
Yes.
That is quite metal poor, around 2.45, you can see in table six, and for Pisces 2 and minus 2.55 for Pegasus 3. Uh-huh. But we assume these metallicities, but we use also the metallicity that we derived overlapping the stellar isochron with our color magnitude diagram.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we saw a metallicity that is around minus 1.7 for Pisces 2 and minus 1.6 for Pegasus 3. Yeah. And as you can see, follow the line of this, in this table of the distance moduli, you see that basically these distance moduli are identical.
Yes.
So Pisces and Pegasus, Pisces 2 and Pegasus 3 are basically at the same distance. In kiloparsec is 175 for Pisces 2 and 174 for Pegasus 3. So at the same distance.
Mm-hmm.
These values are in agreement with the value that we obtain using the Muravev relations and also using the Clementine relation, but assuming a metallicity, lower metallicity.
Right.
Because of the large error, of course.
Yep.
And are also in agreement with the value coming from the literature that are listed also in table two of this work.
Uh-huh.
And so we, as I said before, we used the distances coming from the bona fide R-star, assuming a higher metallicity, assuming the adopting the Clementine et al. Relation, and using these distances, we move forward to other kind of tests. The first test has been try to have some information on the pulsating properties of the bona fide R stars and try to compare the pulsation properties of our R star with the pulsation properties of the other R stars in the Milky Way ultrafaint dwarf spiral galaxies. Uh-huh. And this comparison is the period amplitude diagram, so the Bailey diagram, known as also Bailey diagram, that is, I guess, figure 5.
Indeed.
Okay.
Yep.
In figure 5, you can see the period amplitude the period amplitude of the R stars of Pisces and Pegasus with the blue and red symbols, mm-hmm. of the bona fide R stars, but also we plot in this figure the V2 and V4, considering them AB stars, so adopting the pulsation period and amplitude of this assumption. Mm-hmm. And as you can see in this plot on the right, there are the fundamental pulsator, so the AB star, and on the left, the C stars, so the first overton pulsator. The R stars are divided in these two groups. In Pisces and Pegasus, we have only the AB stars.
Yeah.
And the Ostrov 1 and Ostrov 2 are two ridge lines which define two loci. The Ostrov 1 R stars are not only R star characterized by pulsation periods shorter than the Ostrov 2, but seems that has been found in different work that these this difference is reflect also a difference in terms of metallicity. So the R stars Ostrov 1, so placed in this plane closer to the Ostrov 1 ridge lines, are also characterized by a metallicity that is higher, so yeah. Around -1.5. Instead, the R stars with the longer period closer to the Ostrov 2 locus are characterized instead by a metallicity that is lower, so around -2, -2.5.
Cool.
And the first thing looking only at Pegasus and Pisces is that the bona fide R stars are closer to the Ostrov 1, mm-hmm. and the, let me call them the candidates R stars, so V2 and V4 are in the opposite place.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny, let me say, because we have these two galaxies, we are trying to understand their properties, try to understand if they are similar, and what we have found is that they have the two R stars, and these two R stars are exactly, the behavior of these two R stars are, the behavior is exactly the same. If V2 and V4 are R stars, members of these galaxies, of course. Mm-hmm. If not, we have to think about that the fact that the ultrafaint dwarf spheroidal galaxies are characterized, these two ultrafaint dwarf spheroidal galaxies are characterized by Ostrov 1 properties is quite weird, because generally, as you can see there, the R stars are distributed in the middle,
yeah.
between Ostrov 1 and Ostrov 2 properties.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And this is due to the fact that the ultrafaint dwarf spheroidal galaxies are characterized by a wide spread in metallicity, in some cases around 1 dex. And there is not enough literature to understand why systems so small with these low masses are characterized by this spreading, yeah. metallicity, but the point is that these systems are characterized by this spreading metallicity.
Yep.
But there are also ultra-faint dwarf spheroidal galaxies like, let me say, Phoenix 2 or GRU 1 or Hercules. Uh-huh. Or Canes Venatici 2 that are characterized by RR stars that are basically closer to the Ostrov 2 ridgeline and so are Ostrov 2 systems. Anyway, now the after this also this plot we arrive to this conclusion. We have to better understand the nature of VU2 and VU4. And also try to understand not only if they are anomalous CFIDs or RR star, but also try to understand if they are member or member or not of the of the galaxies. To do that, we try to perform different kind of tests.
Okay.
Different kind of tests, and in the appendix A, there is a quantity of tests to understand, for example, if these systems, if these galaxies, can have anomalous CFIDs, if these are members or not of the galaxy, and but at the end of the story, the conclusion about this test has been okay. These stars cannot be anomalous CFIDs, members of the galaxies, and cannot be anomalous CFIDs belonging to the Milky Way field. So we. Going back to the hypothesis that these stars are RR star, we try to justify their presence in these galaxies and try to understand if they can be members of these galaxies. And so the first thing that we try to understand if has been try to understand if this spread in metallicity, so if it's true that VU4 in Pisces 2 is characterized by this higher luminosity, higher than the VU1, and with this longer period, and maybe with this low metallicity, try to understand if this galaxy can have this spread in metallicity. So I around also in this case point let me say 0.8 dex or something like that. Okay. And so in figure 6 it's illustrated a test that we perform to convince ourselves that these stars VU4 in Pisces 2 and VU2 in Pegasus 3 are RR stars belonging to this system. Okay, so in figure 6 is plotted the color magnitude diagram of Pisces 2.
Yep.
And the colors are exactly the same colors that we see in the map. So the magenta square is the V1, the bona fide RR star. Uh-huh. The red circle is V4, so the candidate variable star. And the red empty circles are the spectroscopically confirmed member stars.
Cool.
RGB stars.
Uh-huh.
And the overlapped track is an evolutionary track of a 0.8 solar masses. That is the typical mass of an RR star.
Yeah.
And we anchor this track to the distance of Pisces 2, the distance that we performed using VU1.
Okay.
And these tracks are tracks assuming different metallicities, going from minus 2.5, the purple one, to minus 1.5 dex. So these are the different metallicities of the tracks in this panel. And as you can see, all the tracks well fit the horizontal branch. Considering the horizontal branch, the magnitude level going from the V4 to the V1.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so this kind of test tell us that it's possible that V4 is a star, an RR star in this galaxy.
Okay.
And to better convince ourselves, we tried also to calculate the probability to find Milky Way field R restarts at the distance of Pishes 2.
Okay.
We use the Medina et al. 2018 radial density distribution. And so we use this distribution, assuming the distance of Pishes 2 and the field of view of the Large Binocular Telescope, the probability to find an array star belonging to the Milky Way field is 10 to minus 9. Yeah. So it's quite impossible, let me say. And so this is the last test that we perform to convince ourselves that these stars, V4 in Pisces 2, but also V2 in Pegasus 3, because we performed the same test for Pegasus 3, are absolutely members of these galaxies.
Cool.
So now we can go to the color magnitude diagram. So we can go to figure, I guess, 8 or 9.
Okay.
Where we show the color magnitude diagrams of both galaxies. Okay. Galaxies on the left, Pisces 2, on the right, Pegasus 3. In figure 9, you see the overlapping with the stellar isochron.
There you go.
Uh-huh. The stellar isochron are basically stellar isochron at the same age, because we know these galaxies host all stellar population, and also we don't see any sign of intermediate or young stellar population. And these stellar isochrons are covering an range of metallicities from minus 1.5 to minus 2.3. Different colors, different metallicity. This is the the story. And what we conclude? We conclude looking at the overlapping with the stellar isochron that the galaxies, both these galaxies, host for sure an all stellar population, ancient stellar population older than 12 giga years, around 13 giga years. We use the stellar isochron of 13 giga years.
Okay.
With a metallicity, if we try to fit with the stellar isochron the RGB star that is traced by the spectroscopically confirmed member stars, and V1 by a stellar population, stellar isochron that represents a stellar population that is more metal rich than we expected, around minus 1.7 for Pisces 2 and around minus 1.6 for Pegasus 3.
Okay. Okay.
And if we want to trust, if we want to trust in the V4 and V2 in in these two galaxies, we can think that exists also a secondary stellar population traced by this star with a metallicity that is compatible with the metallicity that has been found by spectroscopic study. But we don't see, in particular in Pisces 2, sign of a sort of RGB star that can be steeper than RGB stars. Yes, that can be, can follow a steeper shape to justify the presence of an all more metal poor stellar component. Yeah. Instead, in Pegasus 3, but maybe this is only a speculation, if you look at the stars, few stars close to V2 in Pegasus 3, you see that maybe these stars can show a sort of steeper RGB star. But this is only a speculation. We have few stars to say that.
Cool. Okay.
So the last thing, because of we demonstrate that these systems are characterized by the same properties, has been tried to understand if they have a sort of connection, in which way, trying to plot the isodensity control map. So we selected the horizontal branch, main sequence, RGB stars, and we try to make some isodensity control map of these regions, trying to minimize the contamination of the Milky Way contaminants, selecting all the sources that are within 0.1 magnitudes respect to the stellar isochron best fitting. And so in figure 11, yes, you see the isodensity control map of Pisces 2.
Yep.
And with the different subsamples.
Mm-hmm.
And in the central part, you see an overdensity, of course. This overdensity is the body of the galaxy.
Yeah.
But there are no sign of irregular shape, distortion, or something like that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Also, considering that the location of Pegasus 3 is in the lower right direction in this plot. And going to isodensity control map of Pegasus 3, yes, figure 12, you see in the plot on the left an high concentration in the center. Okay, again, we see the body of the galaxy. The point is that there are some other overdensity close to the body, around the body.
Yeah.
And you can say, oh, nice. No, the point is that these are artifacts due to the fact that during the observation of Pegasus 3, yes, happened an unexpected rotation of the of the large binocular telescope. And so there are regions in the field of view that in which the observation are deeper. And so we have a high concentration of stars. And the fact that they are artifacts, are fakes, is also confirmed by the plot on the left, on the right, sorry, in which you see that these artifacts are reduced because we use to plot these control maps only the RGB and main sequence stars.
Yeah.
And so, and again, no irregular shapes in this contour, and also the direction of Pisces 2 in this plot is on the in the upper upper left direction. So no way to see a sort of overdensity in this direction. Yes.
Okay, got it. Yes, yes, I'm with you.
Yeah, so at the end of the story, we conclude that for sure these galaxies are characterized by the same properties, as you can see. So having also similar issues in such a way, but there is not a connection among them using the our data.
Okay.
So we try to make some hypotheses on these galaxies that share similar properties but have not a sort of connection.
Mm-hmm.
And the first hypothesis is that maybe they are remnants of a galaxy, large galaxies that has been totally disrupted by the Milky Way in an encounter that happened giga years ago.
Uh-huh.
Or maybe there could be satellites of a dwarf that has been totally cannibalized by the Milky Way.
Okay.
Or maybe they just by chance are showing similar properties and are so close in the sky. Maybe they have a completely different origin.
Uh-huh.
Or last thing, they can be born in a pair, but the connection, the stellar stream that we would like to see, maybe didn't survive. So these are the hypotheses that we opened at the end of this work.
Mm-hmm. Very cool. Very cool. Nice. Alicia, I want to thank you so much for walking us through your really lovely article here. Nice work.
Thanks very to nice. You for giving this opportunity to talk on this
sure. And you touched on a little bit, so let me just follow up. Where do we go from here, given the published article? Are there additional observational campaigns with LBT? Are there other theoretical work that could be done? Where do we go to continue deciding amongst those four different conclusions which one might be the one?
Yeah, there are we. Ask for new data, LBT data, to better constrain the periods of the uncertain classified stars within certain classification, and so to better constrain the period and the classification of these stars, of course. We also are asking for observations spectra, not only photometry, but also spectra, to have a sample of RGB stars to trying to study the metallicity in these stars, trying to have a bigger sample, respect the sample that we used as a reference, and using this sample to study, for example, the try to obtain the metallicity distribution function to have information on the star formation episodes in this galaxy, so small, but yeah, characterized by this huge spread in terms of metallicity.
Yes.
And the other thing is try to wait for the LSST data. So add astrometric and photometric information and data. And so try to, in a such a way to have the possibility to better constrain the members of these galaxies and try to have more information in terms of the properties of these systems, and try also to better investigate the field around this galaxy and try to understand if, for example, we need more data just to see a possible connection among them, or just to better understand the nature of this curious object. These are the
awesome. Lots of good stuff coming up. I look forward to seeing some of the future work on these, in particular, these two UFDs. So it'll be very cool. Very cool.
Thanks a lot.
Alicia, thank you once more for walking us through your paper. And okay, everyone, that'll do for this one. And I hope this made your astronomy day just a little bit better. And we'll see you on the next one. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.